We're going to talk about growing a small business local economy with marketplace e-commerce, kind of a subset of e-commerce. And what I've been kind of doing with this talk is sharing a story of one of my clients. So one of my clients is a local downtown business association in the Midwest. So I'm from Michigan. We use our hand to tell you where we're from. Actually, it's this way or this way, depending on which hand you want to use. But I'm about right here, middle of the state, and we're a really small town. There's about 15,000 people total, and I get to the fortunate to work from home for a much larger company and still live in that small town. So for me, it all started at one of the places I frequent, which is a coffee shop. How many people are remote workers or work out of your house? It can get very lonely, right? And so, because it gets very lonely, I like to try to go and see people and find ways to just really be social. And so for part of my week, I will spend a couple days at a coffee shop. And so while I was at this coffee shop, the head of the downtown authority started talking to me. He asked me what I was doing, what did I, you know, who did I work with, was I taking on any clients. He had this problem he was trying to come up with. And so I really started at that. And so I really want to tell you that if you do work for yourself or you work for even an agency, sometimes being in a coffee shop can land you business. It's crazy, but it can. So this company or this organization is a Main Street DDA. That's like their official title. It's locally owned businesses to be a part of this. There's in fact 25 separate businesses there. They're all single retail fronts. And what that means is that they have one brick and mortar store. That's the only thing that they have, and they're all community minded. So they really try to give back to the community and make sure that the community is they're doing something with the community. How many people have heard of Amazon, Walmart, Costco, Target? Okay, you've hopefully seen a trend. They're not this type of audience. And so before we can really dive deeper into this audience, we need to kind of understand what the retail space looks like. So let's talk for a moment about retail stores. Now this is all a story around this group, and I'll promise you it may not make sense when we throw a lot of data at you, and it's kind of cool data, but this is what small businesses are going through. This is the mindset they're in to stay in business when you talk about Costco and Walmart and Target and Amazon. So this is a picture of a mall. Does anybody know what a mall looks like these days? Maybe a few of us, right? I think there's one over here in Cambridge. Cambridge Galleria, I think is where I was at, but I believe it does not look like this, right? It's more vibrant. Well, in 2017, 6,400 retail stores closed. Now this is businesses that are closing for good. If we break that down a little bit, we can take a look at this. Family Christian bookstores, this is where people would go and get religious Christian material. They completely went bankrupt. 240 locations across the U.S. are gone. You can't go and buy books from them anymore. Radio Shack, I used to go to Radio Shack a lot. I'd go get my cassette tape player, my CD-ROM player, eventually I'd get my MP3 player there. They're still in the process. You can probably find a few of them still around in smaller towns, but over 1,000 of them have gone. They can't keep up with Amazon, they can't keep up with Walmart. Gymboree, I have two young kids. One is 3 years old, and so she's now getting to a point where I could have shopped at Gymboree, but I can't, because 800 locations are now gone. They're done. Payless Shoes is another one. 900 stores gone. And finally, Yonkers. Yonkers is probably one of the most well-known of this list. Yonkers is what malls would call a pillar store in a mall. At least in the Midwest, our malls tend to be like a cross shape, and at the end of each hallway there would be a Macy's or a Yonkers, a JCPenney's, Mervyn's, if I date myself a little bit there. Yonkers was one of those stores, and 256 locations, they closed up right after Christmas 2 years ago. So more and more retail spaces are just, they're going to the wayside. They're leaving, and they're closing. And they're, most businesses are shutting down their retail spaces in favor of investing in e-commerce experiences. I can expand my audience, I can expand my reach in the digital age by doing something e-commerce based. So that's where small businesses are struggling. The job market is struggling. 448,000 jobs have been lost due to retail store closures. That's crazy. And when we think about it, as a small business, you likely only have 2, 3, maybe 5 or 10 employees at most. They really have an uphill battle to remain in business, right? If these big stores that I just mentioned couldn't stay in business and they're closing multiple locations, how does a small business that only has one brick and mortar store stay open, right? And so I hopefully have prefaced this with why we're seeing this happen, but let's take a look at that for a moment. The rise of e-commerce, right? In the last 15 years, 178,000 jobs have been created that are related to e-commerce. A few months ago, I was driving through Ohio. Anybody from Ohio here? No, okay, didn't move. One, okay. So it's a drive-through state for me. I have to go to if I go to Chicago, it's typically Ohio and Indiana, and so Ohio is one of the largest e-commerce distribution centers. What I mean by that is they have just massive amounts of industrial space where a lot of the e-commerce businesses are putting up warehouses to then ship their products all over the U.S. and in the world. And what's fascinating to me is that they have found a way that by closing brick and mortar stores and really hurting the job market, right, 448,000 jobs have been lost, they're only bringing back about half of that, just under half of that, right? And they're doing that because of those types of decisions. So let's talk e-commerce specific. Let's talk about this guy. We all know this site. How many times a day, we check this? It's probably upwards of 5 or 10. You hear about a deal, or we just had Prime Day. If you're a Prime member, you had 2 days worth of some amazing deals. I heard that they did more this Prime Day than they did in the last 2 years of Black Friday and Cyber Monday revenue wise. So. Amazon, right, is the 10,000-pound giant. But there's another one, Best Buy. Best Buy has continually found ways to be in our lives. They used to do car radios. Does anybody remember going and getting an aftermarket car radio? It used to be the back, way back, like, corner. At least it wasn't my Best Buy. If you wanted to get those big subwoofers and you wanted really good audio, you'd go to Best Buy and you'd get it. They now then went to music. So they sold guitars and drums and keyboards, and people stopped buying that, so they reused that section for, I think mine uses it for vacuums and other random Internet of Things house-related products. So Best Buy has continually found a way in our lives. A funny story, and I forgot to pull it out. So let me pull it out. In this bag is something that I needed a little while ago. this guy here is an external hard drive. Nowadays, it seems to be when you buy a computer, you can't just go in and upgrade the hard drive space. You have to buy a new computer, or you buy one of these. I was in that mode about a month ago, and needed a hard drive to just move some stuff off of my computer and be able to use it on an iPad Pro. Now my option was, I have a Best Buy 45 minutes away, and I try to shop local as much as possible, so this is kind of what I had to go through in doing that. I drove 45 minutes one way, right, so that's 90 minutes of my time just driving, okay? Then you walk into the store, and keep in mind, I already know exactly what I want to buy, okay? I did the research online. This device is a solid state 1 terabyte hard drive. It's USB-C. It could have a carabiner clip on it, and it's pretty durable. And so this is the exact device I wanted. So I get to Best Buy, and at least my Best Buy has a security guard right at the front, so he welcomes me and says hi. And then I go back halfway through the store, find where they're selling this product. But if they don't have it in stock, what happens? Do I pick another product? Do I go home empty-handed? Do I find something else that I might need? Right? These are decisions that we have to make when we buy local, or at least in our community. Unfortunately, that's not the case for me in this case, because I needed this exact one. I didn't want any other one. And so I chose not to go that route and not to drive to Best Buy, because I figured my time of 90 minutes plus the chance that they might not have it in stock wasn't worth it. So I went to Amazon. I have a Prime account, and I went and got it, and 2 days later, actually I think I paid the $3 or whatever to get it next day, and I had it the next day. But that saved me time, right? And that's, as consumers, what we go through in that decision making. And then of course, I got the device I wanted, it's right here, and it's pretty cool. So my daughter plays with it when I lose it. That's a choice that we make, right? That's the choice as consumers we have to make, and as small business owners, we have to understand that this is what people that are consuming our products, looking for the products that we sell, struggle with. In the e-commerce space, they have seen a 14.3% growth in 2018. I'm really excited to see what that number grows to, because my guess is it's probably going to be upwards of 20 to 25%. But Amazon last year saw 40% of all U.S. Online retail orders. 40%. That means that one company is dramatically improving e-commerce, which is cool from a technology perspective, but from a retail or a small business perspective, to let a large company have that kind of control becomes really hard to see how you stay in business. The last little stat I'll share about the e-commerce sales is that if you look at all retail sales in the U.S., 51.9% were done online. And so we can see that this trend is just going online, online, online. It's easy to pull out a phone. It's easy to pull out your laptop. You see something on Facebook or Twitter, you can click a button and you can go right there and you can order it. And that's the world that we're starting to live in. Now, when we're looking at e-commerce sales, and I started to mention this already, but when we pull out our lovely mobile phones here, we see 34.5% of e-commerce sales are done on phones. And it makes sense, right? Because if you are casually scrolling through Twitter right now, and you're thinking about who you're going to have lunch with or what conversations you're going to have, if you're on Twitter, you might see a product. You might see that product, and you might click on that link, and you might add it to your cart, and then I just said something that got you to look at me for a second, and you forgot about that card. But mobile phones are drastically changing our life, and when we look at it in sales, it's a drastic change as well. And so, what we can relate to this is that business growth can be attributed to e-commerce sales. We know that if we have a mobile site or if we have a mobile shopping experience for our customers, they're going to buy from us. They're going to buy because we can target them on Facebook, we can target them on Google, we can retarget them, we can show them our product at any given point in time, and they can buy it. And so, when you look at Amazon, you look at Walmart, you look at Best Buy, they are large companies. They have a massive amount of money to spend in not just a digital e-commerce experience, but also digital marketing and advertising. And so, how can small business retailers compete with those types of high-dollar budgets? What is it that they can do to do that? And so, we're gonna put a pause, and this is the question, this is the like main point I want to drive home in this entire talk, is that this small business association asked me this question. They said, how can small business retailers, how can we compete with these high dollar budgets that Amazon and others are pushing? How many people are living in the retail space, or have lived it, or have a relative that lives in, or pay out a lot? So, a couple of you. All right, so let's talk about retail space, because there's a big ebb and flow. Is everybody familiar with like an ebb and flow, or a high and a low time? So, 30% of a retail store, okay, their annual revenue is going to come, and it's going to be made during the holiday season. And the holiday season is roughly a few weeks before Thanksgiving, and then through the Christmas season, so through the end of the year. You might see a little bit, depending on what survey or data source you take a look at, you might fall that over into January and partially into February. And so retail stores, they see 30% of their annual revenue in about a quarter to a quarter and a half of the year. Now, jewelers will see close to 40%. My dad has run a retail store for 48 years, and all he sells is bicycles. In Boston, you guys probably use bicycles a lot. I see ones that you can rent. But in the Midwest, it's really harder for us. It's a recreational sport. It's not just a tool to get you from point A to point B. And so for him to stay in business for 48 years, that's astonishing to me, especially as you start to see retail spaces slow down. So I asked him some of this. I was trying to understand, you know, what does his revenue look like in a given year? And he actually sees closer to 50% of his revenue happens during the holiday season, because people are always looking at their kids they want a bike for their kids, or someone's going off to college and so they need a bike, and so he sees it around there. But when you look at that holiday season, he's seeing close to 50%. Of his revenue happening during that holiday season. Now, in order for us to understand our consumers a bit, let's take a look at what we spend on average during that holiday season. So this is a good one. We're going to spend $1,000. Let's just round it to $1,010. During that holiday season, and it's broken down kind of crazy. $637 are going to be spent on gifts. $215 are going to be food for all the parties that we have, donations, flowers, greeting cards. And then This is funny. The retail space has started to get at us too, right? So they offer deals that we might likely want to spend money on. And so we're going to spend $154 on ourselves to buy that gadget gizmo that we get a deal on and we see. And so $1,010 is roughly what we spend during that holiday season. That's per person, right? So, you as a household, you might spend more than that. And so what small businesses need to do is they need to find a way to attract more of that holiday spend into their small business. How do they find ways to attract that small business or that retail space? And so the second question that this group kind of came up with after I was kind of talking them through, you know, here's the state of retail space, here's the state of the e-commerce space, is what can small businesses do to capitalize on bringing some of that spend, so roughly $1,010, into their business? What can they do to do that? And naturally, the answer for this small business, or this small business association rather, was to find a way to build an e-commerce component of their business. So in order to do that, let's take a look at what some associated costs are to start an e-commerce business. And this is specific to wanting to control everything. Okay, so you can go to Shopify or BigCommerce, Squarespace, Wix. I think even has an e-commerce component, and you can do some things there. But I really consider that a hobby business, not a true. If I'm a retail business, I've been in business for a while. I'm not going to go there. So you're going to own everything. So in order for us to own everything, here's a very simplified list. I need a domain, because without a domain, I can't have anybody go to my site. I need web hosting. I need email hosting. And somebody asked me once, why is web hosting and email hosting separate? And in the e-commerce space, it's important to keep these separate, because if you're generating a lot of traffic to your site, and you're getting orders to come through, you want those emails to not take away server resources from being able to serve your site and get people to order products and go through the checkout process. So you really want to have that email separate. Next, you need credit card processing, because you can't do online orders without some sort of a credit card processor. If you're running e-commerce and a retail space, you're going to need some sort of an inventory system, and it may need to be connecting your existing inventory system with the e-commerce site, or it might just, you need to implement an inventory system as well. You need some sort of shipping component, because you're going to be shipping, so you have to think through, do I just pick one shipping carrier? Do I just pick UPS or FedEx, or do I just do USPS? So you're going to have that shipping component you need to think about. You're going to have design. You're going to want to have your site be somewhat designed, so you might have some associated costs there. And then just development software. So you're going to need an e-commerce platform. If you're in the WordPress space, you're going to use WooCommerce. You might want to use some added plugins, and so there's going to be some costs there. All right, so what does this look like in dollars? If a professional does it, somebody that builds e-commerce sites for a living, how much do you think that's going to cost?
How many products?
I heard somebody, but I couldn't hear what they said.
I was saying it depends on how many products they have.
Okay, depends on how many products they have. Okay, how about a dollar amount? That's a good answer. I never actually thought of it that way. I'm going to have to rethink this slide a bit. So I'm just going to ballpark it for you. It's $10,000 roughly But I've done enough research to check different agencies, small or large, for a basic e-commerce site. If a professional does it, it's going to cost you around 10 grand. If you try to do some of it yourself, right? You're a developer, or it's a father-son, daughter type, some sort of a relationship where you're going to do some and they're going to do some. You could get it down to $5,000. So this association, right, when I gave that to them, they're like, holy cow, $10,000 is like my entire advertising budget for the year. They can't afford it. In some cases, businesses can't even afford $5,000 for the year to do this. And so, on one hand, I'm looking at it and I'm saying, well, if all 25 small businesses were to build a site, I could be taking home $150,000 to $250,000. And that's going to give me enough business for a year. But I found another way to do that. And that's a marketplace e-commerce platform. So how many people have ever bought or looked at Etsy before? Okay? Now, would it be surprising if I told you that that's exactly what a marketplace platform is? A couple of you are saying yes. So Etsy allows any business to start selling online. So it was actually started by, I don't know if it was started by, but one of the reasons it was started was to help, there was a need for army wives that were making products and selling them to help with their income for a family. And so that's why that was started. It gave anybody that had this niche idea of a product to go start. And today it's much bigger than what it was. And so in WooCommerce and inside of WordPress, we have a similar solution called Dokken. Dokken is the complete multi-vendor e-commerce solution for WordPress. And what this does is it allows each individual store many of the features that you would normally get in your own e-commerce platform, but at a much greater cost savings. So each individual store has, they have their own dashboard, there's their own inventory management system built in. Each store gets their own storefront, so they can have a URL that would go directly to their store. Even better, because it's a marketplace site, you could just go to the main site or the main store page and you can see all the products from all the stores. It gives you a payment gateway right out of the box. You have the ability to share carts, so you're not just limited to purchasing from one business. You could purchase multiple products for multiple businesses. For us WordPress developers or site builders, it's short code based, so you don't have to worry about it working with your theme and writing extra theme code. It's going to virtually work with any theme out there. And so this is what I presented to this client, and I spent about 2 days building it for them at a fraction of the cost that it would take for one site to be built, or one store to be built. And so when we launched this platform, we saw 16 of the 25 businesses join at launch. That gave us substantial savings to build in further into what other features that Dokken doesn't include. We're getting ready to launch a subscription service. So we have a couple of businesses that are doing a collaboration in the store now. That one person makes chocolate, another one makes popcorn, and then there's a coffee shop. And so they're going to make a subscription box that people could buy, and it will be different chocolates and popcorn and coffee that you could purchase, and they'll purchase through a subscription model. So this is a great way for small businesses to build and have that e-commerce component without having such high overcosts to where they can focus on spending that money on advertising. So by focusing on those e-commerce sales, small businesses can see growth. They're not going to see the growth that Amazon and Walmart and the big see, but they can see growth. They can see growth that hopefully hits not just that holiday season, but hits all year around. And so, obviously, partnering with other local businesses, forming alliances or other organizations, they can help save money and in some cases, save your business. Of those 16 businesses that joined at launch, four of them were like months away from having to close their doors. In the year that this site has been launched, they have seen double-digit growth, and it's really saved their business. So, this, if you have small businesses, if you're near to that area, you can do something similar. So, my name is AJ Morris. I'm the Product Innovation and Marketing Manager over at iThemes. It's a liquid web owned company. I'd love to talk about marketplace e-commerce or just WooCommerce in general with you. Our booth is right outside the doors, right before you go to lunch. So if you want to stop by or stop by after lunch, you can do that. And I will open it up to questions. Yeah?
What's the name of the website that you built?
The website that I built, I do not have permission to give that to in a recorded demo, but I slipped up about 2 weeks ago. So if you go to WordPress.tv, you can probably find it there. And now I'm okay with my contract.
How much did you charge for the marketplace site?
I didn't quite hear the question, sorry.
How much did you charge for the marketplace site?
All right, I think the question was how much did I charge for the website? Right? Okay. So if we look at just the e-commerce component, I charged $2,000 for. But this site had also been pre-built, so there was a lot of things that were done with it. In the end, though, I charged them about $10,000 because I was inheriting a site that a designer had previously built for them. They needed other functionality aside from this e-commerce component, so I just tacked this on to an existing project that I had with them. Yeah?
How does
Bill
Can compare to WooCommerce?
I think the question was, how does Dokan work with WooCommerce?
Compare.
So, Dokan is a portion of WooCommerce. So you have to have WooCommerce installed as a store in order to use Dokan. But what Dokan does is it kind of associates users and it hooks into WordPress and WooCommerce to do all the ordering, the cart process. But what Dokan does is associates the user as a store owner, and so as there's some correlation there, you can have individual stores within a greater store. Yes?
You mentioned it having API out of the box. Specifically, which one does it ship compatibility?
Yeah, so the question was how does Dokan comes with a payment gateway out of the box. Out of the box, it uses PayPal. They have an add-on for Stripe Connect. So one of the pieces as a site builder, store builder, or developer that you have to think through is how do you pay out the individual stores? So if you have product A, B, and C are from three different stores, you manually have to pay out each individual business or individual store. With Stripe Connect, that money can immediately go into that store owner's account. So they have to set up their own Stripe account, and then once that's all set up, they will get that portion of every cart checkout that they do. Yes?
Given that you have more than a dozen businesses relying on the site, it seems like uptime is critical. So two questions to you.
Can you drop your voice a bit. Can you speak up a little more?
So just given that you have some
microphones.
Yeah, if those microphones work, that'd be better.
So that given you have more than a dozen businesses relying on the sites, uptime seems very critical. So A, do you use private hosting, sorry, dedicated hosting? And B, do you have some other third-party service maintaining the site and guarantee it?
So the I believe the question was around hosting and how do you host this type of
service? And maintaining the site as well.
And maintain them?
Yeah.
So this is a bit different than multi-site install, right? Multi-site WordPress would basically be one WordPress installation with many sites. From a concept perspective, that's kind of the way you would think about a marketplace or vendor management solution, right? There's multiple vendors or multiple stores that are all utilizing a similar code base. So that's part one. In terms of hosting, it's just like any other WordPress host. So you could you could look at Liquid Web, who actually has a managed marketplace e-commerce plan that includes Dokan and Dokan Connect, which is kind of where I went. So I paid one price and I got the plugin, the hosting, and everything for that client. In terms of maintenance, it's just maintaining any other type of WordPress site. So you've got plugin updates, theme updates that you might have, and I roll that in to like a recurring, a monthly recurring revenue model where I'm doing hosting and maintenance for the client who ends up being the association.
So what if the site goes down and you're on vacation?
So if the site goes down while I'm on vacation, don't tell my wife, but I'm never on vacation. I'll get an alert on my phone and then fix it. But it's never went down in the 2 years that we've been running. So that's out of time. I'm on time. All right. So if you have more questions, find me at the booth. I'll be there.